Pastor Patricia Hamer. Welcome to Abiding Faith Christian Center's Thursday night Bible study. My husband, Pastor Rodney, and I are excited about you joining us on tonight and about bringing you the Word of God on today. Our mission is establishing, empowering, and maturing lives to fulfill God's divine destiny and His purpose. On tonight, you will be renewed in your mind and built up in your spirit. So get ready, grab your Bible, your iPhone, your iPad, or however you access the Word of God. And also, you may want to get pencil and paper so that you can take good notes. Pastor Rodney has a good word for us, and we don't want you to forget the word on tonight. And while you're getting ready, I would like to inform you that Abiding Faith Christian Center Thursday Night Bible Study is located at Eagle Ridge Community Square. And that's the Eagle Ridge Square Community Center, located at Eagle Ridge Square. And it's at 6101 Eagle Ridge Lane, Flint, Michigan, 48505. That's off Selby between Pearson and Carpenter Road. We invite you to come out on Thursday night and visit with us for just 1 hour, 6 to 7 p.m. in the Word of God. It will not be an hour wasted. So if you're close by, you still have time to get here to get in on the Word of God. So are you ready to hear the Word? Well, here's Pastor Rodney.
Praise the Lord. All right, now I'm on. Well, again, I'm going to have to say welcome to those of you on the video, praise God, because my microphone wasn't on. I guess you could hear me a little bit, but praise God. Amen. Welcome again. Well, we're going to get into prayer, but as I said before, I'm excited about this message that I've been teaching on that the Lord gave me about understanding the basics of the operations of faith, a very vitally important message for the believers to understand how faith operates. Praise God. Now, we're going to pray. I'm going to share the vision, do a brief synopsis of what we covered last week, and then we're going to get on into the message further about the message I'm going to be sharing with you tonight. Praise God. Okay? All right. Bow your heads and let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I want to thank you as a minister of the gospel, as a pastor and a teacher, for the Holy Spirit who shall rise up on the inside of me, that he will think through my mind and he will speak through my lips, and he will minister to the people through me as your vessel tonight. Father, I thank you for the anointing on the inside of me that will destroy yokes and lift heavy burdens in the lives of people. Now, Father, I thank you also that you will confirm your word tonight, that I teach from your holy scriptures, and that this word you'll confirm with signs and wonders following, that it will bring faith to the hearts of the individual, and they'll have faith to receive whatever they need from you. Now, Father, I thank you for doing this because it's according to your will that I pray. I pray that every hearing ear have an ear to hear and a heart to understand by filling them with the spirit of wisdom and the spirit of revelation into the knowledge of you, Father. Open the eyes of the hearers' understanding. Now, and I thank you for doing it because, again, I'm asking that which is according to your will. Now, Satan, I render you notice. You will not hinder any person in the sound of my voice from hearing or receiving the word of God, for I bind you in the name of Jesus Christ. And now, Holy Spirit, have free course throughout this service to minister to the hearts of the people, that they may be edified, comforted, and exhorted. Now, I thank you for doing it, because again, I'm asking that which is according to the Father's will. Therefore, I know he hears me and grants me the petition that I ask of him in Jesus' mighty name. Praise the Lord. All right. Praise God. Remember, our vision for Abiding Faith Christian Center is that through the teaching and the preaching of the Word of God, we will reach the lost, bring restoration to those that are backslidden, bringing hope to the hopeless, and healing to those that are afflicted. We will bring believers to spiritual maturity, enabling them to impact this world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Our mission statement is to establish, empower, and mature believers that they may fulfill God's divine purpose for their lives. Christ. We have written the vision, and we're running with the vision. As we said before, we'll say again, if you're looking for a church with a vision of the Lord Jesus Christ, then Abiding Faith Christian Center is for you. We have the vision, and we're running with the vision, praise God, to reach the lost, bring restoration to those that are backslidden, healing to those that are hope to the hopeless, and healing to those that are afflicted, and to bring you to spiritual maturity that will enable you to impact the world in your home first and in the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we welcome you to come on and join us at Abiding Faith Christian Center. All right. Well, praise the Lord. Let's get into this word. Amen. Again, as I said before, we started a message called Getting Understanding, Understanding the Basics of Operating in Faith. And we said that the word basics, because understanding the basics, the word basics means the central and most important principles of something. That's what basic means. Our foundational scripture for this message, how it came together by the Holy Spirit when he gave this to me, was out of the book of Hebrews, the 6th chapter, and verse number 1. You can turn there in your Bibles if you want to. I'm going to turn there myself, praise God. So bear with me as I bring my Bible up here on my tablet. I like these modern tablets, but I do like my page Bible. I do the study at home on page Bible, but when I'm ministering, I like to use this because it gets me to the scriptures a lot faster than turning the pages and without tearing my pages. Got some tears in my pages because when I'm turning my pages, sometimes I get a little bit heavy-handed. Here in Hebrews, the 6th chapter, verse number 1, listen what the Holy Spirit through the Apostle Paul writes to us, the believer, the church today. He says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, the word doctrine means the established order of God, or the teachings of Christ. He said, let us go on unto perfection. So that implies that God wants us to go on to perfection. Is that true? God wants us to grow, praise God. That's why it says, go, let us. And he says us, that means you and me, let us go on unto perfection. And then he says, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith towards God. Now I'm going to stop right there because we've been teaching about understanding the basics of the operations of faith. Basics, which means the fundamental principles of something. And here we're talking about the Word of God. So God wants us to go on unto perfection of faith towards God. So we share some scriptures we talked about when we first started this message. We gave you about 5 things that show the importance of faith. We saw that we're required to live a lifestyle of faith. We found out that we're supposed to fight the good fight of faith. We found out that we are to receive, we receive salvation and healing through faith. And we found out that we overcome by faith. And then we found out that we also, the only way that we as believers can please our Heavenly Father, excuse me, is by faith. And then last week, we started off and we talked about, we got down to the nitty-gritty, and we begin to teach about the details about operating in faith. And we talked about knowing where faith comes from. And we went to our foundational scripture, which was Romans, the 10th chapter, verse number 17, which is familiar to many people. And here in Romans 10:17, it says, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Well, if faith has to come from somewhere, that means that faith must be somewhere where it comes from. Amen. I know this sounds like a little double talk, but praise God, it bears truth. That is, if faith has to come, as it says in Romans 10:17, the Spirit of God speaking through the Apostle Paul says, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. That means that faith must be contained somewhere else, and that it needs to get from where it is to where it is needed at, and that is in the hearts of the believer. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. We discussed the importance of hearing. It didn't say that faith cometh by having heard. It says faith comes by hearing, and 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 ad infinitum. Faith does not come by having heard. It comes by hearing. So we talked about the importance of abiding in the Word, abiding in the vine, which the vine, which is Jesus Christ, but Jesus and the Word is one. Remember, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, in the book of John, the Gospel of John, the 1st chapter, and the Word was God, and the says in the 14th verse, and the Word was made flesh, and we dwelt among them, and we beheld his glory as the only begotten the Father, full of grace and full of truth. So we see, if you're going to abide in the vine, then our abide in Christ means to abide in the Word. That means to hear the Word over and over again. We found out that the word abide means to take up residence in, have a constant, stable existence in, right? I mean, like when my wife, we got married. We've been married. We celebrated our anniversary on March the 22nd, praise God. And we had a wonderful time. Boy, and I'm telling you, she's just as sweet as she was when I first met her. And when we got married, she was here in Flint, but I was living in Colorado. And she packed up her stuff. She packed up some stuff, and she came to Colorado to live with me. Well, when she came, my wife bought about just about everything, every one of her clothes and all the things that you, the earrings and all the stuff that women have, you know what I mean? And she packed all this stuff, and we piled it up in the car and everything, and we went to Colorado. Now, why did she do that? Why didn't she just bring a couple of suitcases and come down to Colorado when she married me? Well, because she didn't marry me just to be married to me temporarily, and she didn't come down to Colorado when we got married to be there temporary. She came down there to abide with me. That is to take up residence in, to settle down in, and to have a constant, stable existence in. Well, by and by, after we're there for about three years and some months, we felt led by the Lord to come here to Flint, Michigan, so we can come and pastor Abiding Faith Christian Center. And so I sold the house that I lived in there. Why did I sell it? Well, because when I got ready to move and come to Flint, Michigan, I came to abide here, to take up residence here, to settle down here. So I sold my house, and I packed all our furniture and gave some away, and we came back down here with a U-Haul, and we moved here to Flint, Michigan, bringing everything that I had and everything that she had. Why? Because our intent was to abide here in Flint, Michigan. We're living in Flushing, because, you know, we are here to abide. Well, the same thing about the Word of God, my brothers and sisters. It's important for you to abide in the Word of God. And the word abide means you got to hear the Word over and over again. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Of course, we remember we went to Romans 10:8, and Romans 10 says, "But what saith if the word is near thee, and in thy mouth and thy heart, that is the word of faith which we preach." And we found out that the way that faith comes is through the preaching of the gospel. And so that's why it's important, me as a pastor, Pat, as a pastor, we're to teach and preach nothing but the Word when we stand behind the pulpit, when we do Bible studies, whatever we're doing, we should teach and preach the Word, not our opinions. You know, not what we feel and, you know, what we think, but what does God says? And we're to rightly divide it, but the only way you can do that is study the Word of God. Amen? All right, enough of the preliminaries. We want to now move on, because we want to find out how you can know that you have faith. Knowing if you have faith. Knowing if you have faith. Have you ever heard someone says, "Well, Pastor, I don't have any faith. If I only had some faith." You ever heard someone say that? I know you haven't said it yourself, but there are people that do say, "I don't have any faith. If I only have some faith." Well, you heard the disciples one time, they said, "Lord, increase our faith." Well, faith can be increasing. We're going to talk about that some other time. But right now, we want to teach you so that you can know for at any given time that you have faith. Every believer has faith, in case you didn't know it. But I want you to turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Hebrews, to the 11th chapter. And we want to look at verse number 1, Hebrews chapter 11. Probably very familiar with you, Hebrews chapter, the 11th chapter. Familiar with many of you. Many of you in the body of Christ, Hebrews 11 chapter. How you can know that you have faith, praise God. Knowing if you have faith, that's what the title is, knowing if you have faith. Here in Hebrews 11 chapter, many scholars believe that the Apostle Paul was the writer of the book of Hebrews, so we can say that the Holy Spirit is speaking through the Apostle Paul here in Hebrews 11 chapter, verse number 1. And notice what the Spirit of God inspires him to write, so it's God speaking to us. It says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." I want you to notice what it says. It says, "Now faith is." Now, we know that the word "noun" is not a word that you can use it as a time frame, amen? Etymologically, it doesn't mean a time frame, but we can use it as saying a time frame. When it says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for," and then it says, "the evidence of things not seen." The evidence of things not seen. Now, let's break this down here. It says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Now the word hope right here, we can change the word hope and we can say it like this. Now faith is the substance of things desired, wished, or dreamed for. Did you get that? The word hope, we can substitute the words. Now the faith is the substance of things wished for, dreamed for. Amen? The word hope can be used, substitute with the word wish or dream. You ever wish for something? You ever wish for whatever? Yes, I wish I had this, and I wish I was this, and I wish this. Or you may dream. You know, some people daydream, some people dream at night. Amen? And you're dreaming about something, and that's something that you dream about. Maybe a desire, a strong desire in your heart. I don't know, but you're just dreaming. But did you notice? It says that faith is the substance of things dreamed for. Faith is the substance of things hoped for or wished for. Faith is the substance. Now, the word substance can also be defined, well, actually, verse substance means that which has a tangibility. That which can be, that which is tangible. I guess the best way I can put tangible, amen? That's what substance means. It has a tangibility to it, amen? So we say now faith is the substance or the tangibility of things hoped for. And then it goes and says the evidence. What about the word evidence? Well, the word evidence can be the proof of, the substantiating proof of. That's what evidence means. It means the proof of. When you go to court and then you trying to plea, argue your case before a judge and stuff and the jury and stuff, and you saying, well, such and such a thing happened at such and such a time, and they say, well, do you have any evidence? And so, yes, Your Honor, I do have some evidence. I'd like to present to you Exhibit A, which is evidence of such and such a thing, whatever you plead in your case for in court. So it says here, faith is the evidence, the proof. And then it says, of things not seen. The things not seen. Well, you many of you know that there's some things that you can see that you can't hear, or there's some things that you can see that you can't smell, or there's some things that you can see that you can't taste and what have you, or vice versa. There's some things that you can hear that you cannot smell, right? There's some things that you can hear that you can't see. Am I right? I mean, you can hear music coming over a loudspeaker, but you can't see the music, amen? You can't see the notes, praise God, that's coming over the loudspeaker or through earphones you may have or coming through the television, praise God. So when it says here that faith is the evidence of things not seen, we can say faith is not the evidence of things not perceived by the senses, because we don't want to just limit the word seen here in verse number 11 just to visual perception. Because when you read the word seen, that's what you think about. You think about visual perception. So we don't want to just limit it to visual perception. So that's why I said the word seen can also be defined as to be heard, smelled, tasted, or touched. Amen? Now, how do we know that? Well, if you go over with me in the book of 1 Corinthians, I believe you want to go to, see if that's the right place. I just want to share something with you right there. I wasn't going in this direction. That's not in my notes, but I believe the Holy Spirit is leading me to go in that direction. I believe it's the 1 Corinthians, the 4th chapter. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. No, I think it's in 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter. Oh, glory be to God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Is that where I want to go? I think that's the wrong one too. Let's go back to 1 Corinthians. We'll find it in a second here. It was 4:18? Oh man, I just passed right by it, huh? Okay. 4:18? Yeah, 4:18, the last verse here. I was kind of looking in the middle of it. 2 Corinthians 4:18. Turn there. I was over there in the 4th chapter, but I didn't know what verse it was. Here in 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter, verse number 18. Now remember, we're talking about Hebrews 11:1 that says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen, or the evidence of things not perceived by the senses. Well, if you look here at verse number 18 in 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter, that word seen cannot be just limited to visual perception, because it says right here in the 18th verse, while we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporal, are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Now notice what the Spirit of God here and through the Apostle Paul writes. He says, for while we look not at the things which are seen. Well, we know there are things that are seen. There's things that are smelled. There's things that are heard. There's things that are tasted, and there's things that are felt. Amen? So we just can't limit this right here when he says, while we look not at the things which are seen, what about the things which are heard? What about the things which are smelled? What about the things which are tasted? Or what about the things which are felt? Amen? So we see here that the Holy Spirit is not just limited, this word seen, to visual perception, because there's some things that you can see that you cannot hear or you cannot smell, or there's some things that you can taste that you cannot hear or you can, maybe you probably can smell it, amen? Or there's some things that you can hear that you cannot feel, right, or you cannot see. So here the Holy Spirit is not limited just to visual perception. It's talking about the whole sensory mechanism in the human body. Amen? That is smelling, seeing, tasting, touching, and hearing. Amen? So let's read it this way in the 18th verse of 2 Corinthians, the 4th chapter. While we look not at the things which are perceived by the senses, but at the things which are not perceived by the senses, for the things which are not perceived by the senses are temporary, but the things which are not perceived by the senses are eternal. Amen? So what we're saying is that there's things that we can't see, smell, taste, or touch, one of the five senses, or maybe just two of the five senses, so we can contact the physical world. So the Bible's saying that there's things that we can see, taste, smell, and hear, that they are temporary, but the things which are not perceived by the senses are eternal. What is that? That's the Word of God. That's the realm of God. The spiritual realm is eternal, but the physical realm is temporarily. Amen? Let's go back over to the book of Hebrews, the 11th chapter, and let's look at that verse of Scripture, and let's read it in the light of what we just looked at, right there in the book of 1 Corinthians, the 4th chapter. Here in Hebrews 11th chapter, we look at verse number 1. It says, now faith is the substance, the tangibility of things hoped for, and then faith is the evidence of things not perceived by the senses. You see that? So we can see here that faith is the substance of something and is also the evidence of something. So that means that faith must be real. Amen? It has to be real. It's the substance of things hoped for, and then faith is also the evidence of things not perceived by the senses. Amen? That's what Hebrews 11:1 is telling us. It says, faith is the substance of things hoped for, wished for, dreamed for. Wishing and dream has no tangibility to it. It cannot be contacted with the five physical senses. Then it says that faith is the evidence, the proof of the things not seen or not perceived by the senses. You can have a photograph of someone committing a crime, but it's not the actual crime that was committed. It's just a photograph of the crime that was committed some time ago. Amen? It's just the evidence, the proof of it. It's not the thing itself. Amen? Well, the Bible says that faith is the evidence. Faith is the substance of that which is hoped and wished and desired for. In other words, there may be some desires in your heart about your life, about your family, about your children, about your finances, about the healing for your body. You may be wishing to be healed. You may hope to be healed. You may be hoping to be in a nice, wonderful family. You may be hoping to be in a family where there's no turmoil, no trouble and fighting and all kinds of stuff that makes you feel uncomfortable and you can't sleep at night. Someone's messing with you. You may hope for a change in that area of your life. The Bible says that faith can become the substance of those things that you wish and hope for, and it can become the evidence of things not perceived by the senses. Amen? Amen. So this faith stuff that we're teaching about must be very important. Now, remember we found out where faith comes from, right? Because this faith, which is the substance of things hoped for, this faith, which is the evidence of things not perceived by the physical senses, has to come from somewhere. Amen? Amen. It has to come from somewhere. Well, where does it come from? Well, remember Romans the 10th chapter, the 17th verse. Turn to Romans the 10th chapter, the 17th verse, and we're going to find out where this faith comes from. I know you're familiar with it last week. If you were here or you were listening on the Periscope or you looked at it on Facebook or whatever. But we just want to go there. Humor me just to go back it again, because we said before faith comes by hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing by the Word of God. Amen. Hearing on a continuous sense. Romans the 10th chapter. We want to look at verse number 17. 17, because we want to find out about this faith, which is the substance of things hoped for, and this faith, which is the evidence or the proof of things not perceived by the senses. Amen? This faith is the substance, the tangibility of the things that you wish and hope for. Wishing, hoping, it has no tangibility to it. Dreams have no tangibility to it. But faith will give tangibility to your dreams. Faith will give tangibility to your wishes and your hopes. Faith will become the evidence of the thing that you are believing God for until it comes on the scene in the natural. Amen? Now look what it says here in Romans 10 chapter, verse number 17. It says, so then faith cometh by what? Cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So then faith comes by what? It comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Amen? So we see that faith comes from somewhere, as we said earlier. It comes from the hearing of the word. So this faith, which is the substance of things hoped for, this faith, which is the evidence of things not perceived by the senses, this faith, which has a tangibility to it, and which is also can be used as an evidence of that which cannot be perceived by the senses, comes from the word of God, my brother and sister. Amen? Now remember, our subject that we're talking about is knowing if you have faith, knowing if you have the substance of the things that you hope for, knowing if you have evidence of that which you cannot perceive by the senses. Why? Because faith is so important. It's important to live by. It's important to receive healing and to get saved by. It's important because we fight the good fight of faith and lay hold on the promise of God's word. It is also important because we overcome by faith. It's also important because we can only please the Heavenly Father except with our faith. Amen? So we're talking about now the details of operating in faith. So we want to know if we have faith or not. How can we determine? Well, the Bible says in Romans 10:8, but what saith it? The word is near you. You look at a verse there in Romans 10 chapter. You're already there. It says, but what saith it? The word is near you, even in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. We discussed last week and we found out that what we preach is what? The gospel. The gospel is about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The gospel is about the Heavenly Father. It's about the kingdom of God. Everything that pertains to the kingdom of God is found in the gospel. Amen? The will of God, the plans of God, the thoughts of God. The book of Jeremiah, the 29th chapter, verse number 11 says, I know the thoughts that I have towards you, saith God, thoughts of good and not of evil, to give you an expected end, to give you a prosperous future. Amen? That's the thought of God towards everyone of us. Amen. We found also in the book of 3 John, 2nd verse says, beloved, I desire above all things that you may prosper and be in health. Amen. So we find the will of God right there in those verses of scriptures, that it's the will of God for you to be in health. It's the will of God for you to be prosperous. Amen. Now that word that we just gave, those two scriptures become the substance of what people hope, what you hope for. It becomes the evidence of what cannot be perceived by your senses at the present time. But if you get hold of that faith will become substance one day. It will become a material. It will come into existence, what I'm saying, one day. Amen? Now, I'm getting a little ahead of myself, but I wanted to share that. Now, remember now, Hebrews 10:11-1 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence things not seen. It's the substance and the evidence. Well, where do we get this faith from? It comes from the word of God. Romans 10:17. So then faith comes by what? Hearing, and hearing by what? The word of God. That's where faith comes from. Amen? Faith comes from the Bible. That's why many people who are praying to God, trying to get God to answer prayers in their life, coming into their life, they're not getting an answer because they're not going by the word of God. They're not praying in line with God's word. Amen. That's why the Bible says in 1 John 5:14-15, and this is the confidence, the assurance, the reliance we have in God, that if we ask God anything that's according to his will, his word, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, we know that we have the petitions, the prayer requests that we ask of him. Amen. How do we know that? Because we know his will. His will is found in the Bible. That's why you need to come to church so you can find out what God's will is in the Bible, so you can know how to pray effectively. Amen? It's not that God doesn't exist. He does exist. You just don't know how to work the system that God has set in order in his kingdom. You're going to have to work according to God's system. You can't just be out there doing your own thing. You can come to God, but once you come to God, you're going to have to operate according to his system, how he set things up in order for the word to work for you, in order for this word, which is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen, to become effective in your life. Amen? And the fact that he said faith is the substance of things hoped for, he knows that there's a lot of people out there that has wishes, they have dreams, amen? They're desiring things in their life for the future because it's not present right now. I mean, if you're in a terrible life, if you're in a terrible family life, if you're sick in your body, you're dreaming. I hope you dream. I know you're dreaming about being better because that's why you're going to the doctor. That's why you're getting medicine. That's why you're going to have an operation, because you want to be better. That's your hope. That's your wish. Well, God's word can be the substance of that which you wish for, my brother and sister. And not only just the substance, when I say the substance, it can become the materiality of what you want to come to pass. Praise God. That's why you need to know about the understanding of the basics of operating in faith. So we're talking about knowing if you have faith right now. Now listen, look at Romans the 12th chapter and the 3rd verse. We want to find out if you have faith. How you can know if you have faith. How do I know I have faith, Pastor? Well, I'm going to show you right here in Romans the 12th chapter. I'm going to show you Romans 12th chapter in verse number 3, and I'm going to show you some other things in a minute too. Hallelujah. I'm getting excited about this. I need to slow down. Oh, glory to God. Romans 12:3. Ooh, we're already in Romans now. I'm just going to go to the 12th chapter, and we want to look at verse number 3. How can you know that you have faith? Because you need to know that you have faith. Many believers don't believe they have faith. They say, if I only had some faith, can you pray for me that I can get some faith? I don't have any faith, Pastor. Yes, you do. You have faith. You just don't know that you have faith. And the reason why you don't know it, because you've never been taught. You've never been taught it from the Word of God. Some of you have been taught a lot of other things, but you've not been taught the Word of God. You've heard a lot of wisdom of words, but you haven't been taught the word of faith. And that's important for you, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Here in Romans, the 12th chapter, I believe everybody's there by now. Look what it says in verse number 3. For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than you ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God, listen, has dealt to every man the measure of faith. Now, what is a measure? Well, if we had a measuring cup, where it was one fourth, or one third, or one half, or one cup, or what have you, amen? Well, those one half is a measure, one fourth is a measure, one third is a measure, amen? The Bible says God has dealt unto every man, listen, the measure of faith. And according as God, he said, for I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than you ought to think. Don't think that you all that in the bag of chips. Are you better than somebody else because since you came to Christ, you came and you got the same things everybody else got. Amen? Why? Because God is no respecter of person. Now you see different people operating in great faith, people doing a lot of great works for God, preachers, ministries. You see them doing a lot of things for God, people operating in great faith. But that's not because God gave them great faith and didn't give you great faith. It's not because God anointed them more than he anointed you. We all have the same measure of faith, and that's why the Apostle Paul, or the Holy Spirit through the Apostle Paul, is saying to us, he said, for I say through the grace of God given unto me, to every man, every woman that is among you in the body of Christ, not to think of himself or herself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, clear-minded, according as God has dealt to every man, listen, the measure of faith. So God has given to every one of us the same measure of faith. Well, Pastor, when did he give us the measure of faith? Well, I'll show you when you receive the measure of faith. Go over to the book of Ephesians, the 2nd chapter. I'll show you where you received your measure of faith. We all came through the same route. We all came down the same street. Here the street, at the address of Ephesians, the second chapter, and verse number 8. We all came to that address when before we came to Christ. When we finally accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, when we became born again, we had to come to the same address, Ephesians, the address 2:8. Praise God. Ephesians, the second chapter, verse number 8. Notice what it says right here in verse number 8. It says, for by grace, God's unmerited favor, are you saved through what? Through faith and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. Now, how is it the gift of God? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believed in him would not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but the world through him might be saved. Remember over in the book of Romans, I believe it is in the 5th chapter, it says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. While you were a sinner, Christ already died for you. Amen? Amen. Even when he was on the earth, he died for the sinners who was on the earth. He died for the apostles when they were on the earth. They were sinners, but Christ died for us first. Then after he died, then we, through the grace of God, for by grace are you saved through faith. Faith in who? Faith in Jesus and what Jesus did for us. You put your confidence in what he did for you. The Bible says, for by one man death passed upon all men, and by the obedience of one shall all be made righteous, the obedience of Jesus Christ, because he offered himself as a sacrifice for sin. Adam, through his disobedience, caused death to pass upon all men. Adam is the great, 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 great grandfather of every human being on the earth. We all come from one man and woman, which was Adam and Eve. That's why there's no such things as races. Only one race, the human race. That's why all this stuff with prejudice and stuff, racial prejudice, it's a ploy of Satan to keep man in darkness and keep them fighting among themselves when all men come from God. You get below the skin and you see all the organs look the same. In fact, they do transplant organs to one person to another person, and it doesn't matter what color their skin is. Amen? Amen? That right there proves to you. The organs, they can be tried. If they got the same blood type or whatever and stuff, it's able to transplant it. So that's a of Satan. That's why Christians need their mind renewed with the Word of God. Why? Because you need to start thinking like God wants you to think. And that way you have compassion on all people. Amen? And not to run around with prejudice inside of you and say, well, I'll preach to them, when I won't talk to them. I'll go witness to them, but I won't witness to them. I'll pray for them, but I won't pray for them. Why? Because you don't have your mind renewed with the Word of God. You don't know the truth. Jesus says, if you continue my word, then you're my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Amen? Praise God. Kids, when they grow up, they don't grow up with prayers. You see little kids and the toddlers in there, man, they playing with one another. They don't know the difference between black, white, yellow, or pink. Amen? Amen. All to them, everybody looks the same. Amen? Amen? And then even when they get a little older than that, they still have that innocence about themselves. Yes. Yes. It's taught by society. Oh, my. I don't know why I got on that, but I did ask the Holy Spirit to think through my mind and speak through my lips, and he's doing it to somebody on Periscope or somebody that's going to be viewing this tape. Amen? Or maybe doing it to the kids that are here tonight. Praise God. Now, listen, he says, for by grace are you saved through faith and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, the gift which God gave his Son to be the sacrificial lamb for the sins of the whole world, for Adam's sin. And we received that gift. We never seen Jesus die on the cross. I wasn't there. You weren't there. Nobody living today was there. Nobody 30 years ago was there. But we believe the testimony. We believe the gospel that the others have preached to us, that Jesus Christ was crucified, that he died, he went to hell, and was raised again the third day. I believe that. You believe that. We believe it. We receive that testimony, and we receive it by faith. Faith is simply believing the word of someone and acting on it. We believe on the word of someone, and we acted upon it. Romans 10:9-10, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, you will be saved. For with your heart you believe unto righteousness, with your mouth confession is made unto salvation. It's a faith operation. And that faith for you and I to become saved, my brother and sister, came from God, from his word that he had all the apostles and disciples back then in the beginning to preach, and they preached and told someone else about it, and that somebody else that got born again told somebody else about it, and that somebody that told somebody else about it told somebody else about it, and all of a sudden it passed all the way down, and then the Bibles were printed then, and somebody read the Bible, believed it, acted upon it, and it's been preached throughout the whole world, and we all heard the same gospel and the salvation, and we heard it. When we heard it, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. When you heard it, then you received the same measure of faith as the other person did, and you acted upon that same measure of faith, and you became born again.
Yes, yes, yes.
We all received the same measure of faith.
Amen.
Woo, glory be to God. I think I'm preaching myself happy. I don't know about you. Yes, we all receive the same measure of faith. That's what the Bible says. We're not talking about my opinion. We definitely ain't talking about your opinion. But we're talking about what God's word says. And that's why it's important for us to teach nothing but the truth. But the truth, so help me God. And the truth is found in the word of God. Amen?
Yeah.
Romans 12:3, you can turn back there now. We can look at that again. Now, if you are born again... If you are born again, I'm going to emphasize that. If you are born again, if you are not born again and you just going through the fundamentals and stuff and putting on and got all the cliches and you think you're born again but you haven't been born again, you can become born again. But if you are born again, then we all have faith. That's what I'm going to say. If you're born again, you still have faith. All of us received the same measure of faith when you became born again. So, this is how you can know that you have faith. Even if you just got born again, you have faith. The person that just got born again the very second ago, somewhere in the world, somebody got born again, they have the same measure of faith that you started off with. Now, notice I say, they have the same measure of faith that you started off with. But you can grow in faith. You can grow in faith, praise God. And we're going to talk about that later. That's not my subject right now. I want to prove to you that you have faith. And the way faith comes, it comes, it came to you because you heard the gospel unto your salvation. Amen?
Amen.
The gospel unto your salvation is that what you heard. And when you heard it, you believed it. When you believed it, you act upon it, and you became born again. So you know you got faith in your heart. Amen?
Yes.
All right, let me show you another thing. In case you don't know that, let's look at another verse of Scripture. Now, I'm going to give you the definition of the word dealt. And the word dealt in the Greek is the word merizo, M-E-R-I-Z-O. I guess I'm pronouncing it right. Merizo. The word dealt means to divide into parts, to distribute, to divide out, to deal out. Faith is dealt, therefore it comes from somewhere else to where it was not. Amen? In this case, it comes from the hearing of the gospel. The faith, the measure of faith for you to be saved, came from the hearing of the gospel. Amen? Well, let's look at another verse of Scripture, because we want to prove again how you can know that you have faith, because after you became born again, you've grown a little bit, you've heard some more gospel, but you receive faith. This is how you know you got faith in your heart. Turn to Luke, the 8th chapter, verse number 22. We just want to look at some examples. Luke, the 8th chapter, verse number 22. This is how you can know that you have faith. And I'm going to be probably going back over some, it's going to be going back over again scriptures that you may heard last week or week before last, but that's all right, because when you're getting into the truth of God's word, it's like a sweater with all the threads that's interwoven together, amen? And you can't help by, you know, going over something else to teach us particular a subject matter in the Word of God. In this sense, we're teaching about understanding the basis of faith. Amen? If I'm teaching healing, I can use this verse of Scripture concerning healing. But I'm not teaching on healing tonight. I'm teaching on how you can know that you have faith. So I'm going to use this verse of Scripture, which I can use someplace else. Praise God. So here in Luke, the 8th chapter. Luke, the 8th chapter. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I just get excited. We look at verse number 22. It says in verse 22, "Now it came to pass on a certain day that he went into a ship with his disciples and said unto them, let us go over unto the other side of the lake." Now he said, let us. He didn't say, let me. He didn't say, let a few of us. He said, he didn't say just let me and my posse. He said, let us go over unto the other side of the lake. And they launched forth. But as they sailed, he fell asleep. And there came down a storm of wind on the lake, and they were filled with water and were in jeopardy. And they came to him and awoke him, saying, Master, Master, we perish. Then he arose and rebuked the wind and the raging of the water, and they ceased, and there was a calm. And he said unto them, Where is your faith? And they being afraid, one to saying one to another, What manner of man is this? For he commandeth even the winds and the water, and they obey him. Now they're astounded about what he did, but he's telling them when he says, Where is your faith? He's saying that you could have done the same thing that I did. That's what he's telling us. What do you mean, Pastor? Well, Jesus, the way that he was able to rebuke the storm and rebuke the waves was that he spoke to it. Remember over in Mark 11:22 and Mark 11:23, after Jesus spoke to the fig tree and said, No man eat fruit of you henceforth forever, he went into Jerusalem, overturned the money changers' table, chased them out of the temple, came back the next day after they got some sleep. The next day they got up and they passed, went down the same road, passed by the same fig tree. Jesus passed it by, but Peter, he looked at it and saw that it was withered up from the root, and he told Jesus, he called Jesus out and said, Master, Master, behold, the fig tree which thou hast cursed has withered up from the roots. And Jesus then turned around and says, Well, I behold, Peter, can you, I just imagine that. I do declare, it did, Peter. No, Jesus didn't even talk about it. What he talked about was, he said in verse number 22, in Mark 11 chapter, verse 22, you can look it up later, he says, have the faith of God. Have the faith of God. Now in your translation, King James translation, it may say have faith in God, but if you look at the margin of your Bible, very probably a number next to that particular verse of scripture, and you'll notice that it says have the faith of God. Well, having faith in God and having the faith of God is two different things. You can have faith in God and by God's ability, but to have the faith of God is to have something that God has. Amen? And Jesus was telling them, he was telling them there in Mark 11 chapter and verse number 22, he told them, you can have the kind of faith that God has. He was telling the disciples that because he was teaching them through precept and example. He says, have the faith of God. And then he told them how the faith of God operated in verse number 23. He said, for truly I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, you'll have whatsoever he saith. He'll have whatsoever he saith, but you got to believe it in your heart. Believe what? Believe that those things which you saith shall come to pass, you'll have whatsoever you saith. Well, back over here in the book of Luke, the 8th chapter, when Jesus woke up and rebuked the wind and rebuked the sea, and he says, let me look at the verse of scripture because I might be quoting it wrong. Back over here in the scripture, it says, he said unto them, where is your faith? Where is your faith that Jesus asked them? Well, you know, I think I mentioned last week and I used the verse of scripture. And I said, well, Jesus, where are they supposed to get that faith from? Were they supposed to go down to the local store and buy faith with some money? Or Jesus, what were they supposed to do? Were they supposed to have somebody lay hands on them and pray real loud and real strong and they get faith? Pray for me, Pastor, that I might have some faith. No, it doesn't come that way. We just found out that Romans 10:17 says, so then faith comes by what? Faith comes by hearing and hearing and hearing by the word of God. Faith comes from the word. The word brings you faith, amen? The word brings you faith. So when Jesus says, where is your faith? He says, back in the beginning of that verse of scripture, verse number 22, he had sent the multitude away, and he said, let us pass over onto the other side. Us meaning him and them. Us meaning him and them. Amen? When he said, let us, he wasn't just talking about himself. So he got into the ship and went to sleep because he just figured that, well, they got the word. And since they got the word, they got faith. And I'm telling you, my brother and sister, whenever you hear the word, then that's where faith comes from. And once you hear the word, then God expects you to act upon the faith that you receive from the word. That's why many of you have been born again for a number of years. And where you were baby Christian, it was easy for your prayers to get answered. But it seemed like it's not working like it did before. It was easy for God to answer prayer, but it's not so much for now because he expects you to mature and expects you to act upon the faith that you've heard from the teaching of the word. Before you were a baby Christian, you received nothing but milk, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word of God that you may grow thereby. You received the milk. The milk came so you can grow up, and now God expects you to walk on your two faith shoes. your two faith shoes. Amen. You know what your two faith shoes are, right? That means to walk in the faith that you receive from the hearing of the word that you know. You heard your pastor, you heard somebody preach it over and over again, and you have the word in you, and so God expects you to act upon the word that you know. Where is your faith? You can tell you have faith when you know you have some word in you. When you can quote scriptures off, when you know about scriptures and you can quote scriptures off, that scripture that you quote off is faith that has been deposited in your spirit, in your heart, that God expects for you to act upon. Somebody said, well, I know God can heal. How do you know that? Well, the Bible says, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, and he went about doing good, healing all that were oppressed of the devil. I know God heals because when you go back in the Bible and you read about the woman with the issue of blood and how she got healed, how Jesus went about healing all that were oppressed of the devil. I know, Pastor, that God can heal. Well, see, since you know that, that means you got faith in your heart to receive healing for yourself.
Yes.
Yeah, you got faith in your heart to receive healing for yourself. And that's why every time you go down to the prayer line for the preacher to pray for you and they pray for you and you don't receive no healing, it's because you're not acting upon the faith that you have already. You have faith by virtue of the word that's on the inside of you. You can look at it this way. Faith and the word goes together like wet with the water. Have you ever went to a restaurant and you asked the waiter to bring you a glass of water? You sit down in the restaurant and supper table, can you bring me a glass of water also? And the waitress says, yes, I'll bring you a glass of water. Or they may not say it, it's okay, one glass of water, what do you want? Oh, you want some tea, what do you want? I want some pop, we want some pop. And so the waitress walks away, and then you say, oh, waitress, by the way, when you bring the water, can you please bring the wet with the water? You don't do that, why? You don't do that, why? Why? Because wet goes with the water, amen? If you got a glass of water, the water's going to be wet. Why? Because wet goes with the water. If you got the word, if you heard the word, if you received the word, you got faith, because faith and the word goes together like wet with the water.
Yes, yes, yes.
That's how you know you have faith. That's how you know you have faith, because you got the word. Now, some of you may not be acting upon the faith that you have, but you still have faith. You just have to act upon the faith that you have inside of you. Ooh, I don't preach myself happy. I don't know about you. I saw my timekeeper put her hands up, and I thought she was waving at me again. But she's telling me that I'm running out of time. Oh, I got six minutes, huh? All right, praise God. Let's see what I can do in six minutes. Praise God. Let's go to Matthew, the 14th chapter. I want to show you something in Matthew, the 14th chapter. Matthew's chapter 14. If you don't know where Matthew's is, look in the table of contents in the front of the Bible, and it'll tell you what page Matthew's on. Matthew's, the book of Matthew's. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Matthew's the 14th chapter. Matthew's 14:26. Matthew's 14th chapter. Verse number 26. See, when you come to church here, especially Abiding Faith Christian Center, you're going to learn where the books of the Bible are. You're going to learn where the verses are. Amen. So you can turn to it. Here in Matthew's, the 14th chapter, starting at verse number 25. Actually, we start at verse number 24. What did I say the first time start at? 26. Actually, we're going to start at verse number 23. So we're going to look at the 23rd verse. Look at the 23rd verse. And it says, when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. But the ship was now in the middle of the sea, the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. In other words, there was this wind, a storm on the sea, and the boat was trying to go one direction, and the wind was blowing it back in the other direction it was coming from. So it says, and when the disciple, and it says, and the wind was contrary, verse 24 and verse 25 now, and in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, doing what? Walking on the sea. Now that's supernatural, right? That's supernatural. Jesus went to them walking on the sea, and it says they were troubled, saying, "It is a spirit," and they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spoke unto them, saying, "Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid." And Peter, who was in the ship with the other disciples, answered him and said, "Lord, if it be you, he started off with doubt. Jesus just got through saying, "It is I." "If it be you, bid me come unto thee on the water." And he said, what? "Come." Now I want you to notice that Jesus said, "Come." Peter asked him, "Let me come to you?" Jesus gave him permission. Why? He said, "Come." And so all of a sudden, when Jesus said, come, and when Peter was come down out of the ship, he obeyed the word come. And when he was come down out of the ship, that means he obeyed the word come. And faith comes by what? Hearing. And hearing by what? The word of God. And when he was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and began to sink. He cried, saying, "Lord, save me." And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, "Listen, O thou of little faith, wherefore did thou doubt?" So we see that Peter received faith. How? Because Jesus said, "Come." So faith was in Peter's heart that enabled him to walk on the water. It wasn't just the power of God alone. It was Peter's faith acting on the word that he heard that brought faith that enabled the power of God to enable him to walk on the water. And I'm going to have to close there because my time is out. I want to thank you for those of you that come to the Thursday night Bible study tonight. Thank those of you that are on Periscope viewing now. Thank you that are viewing this video recording either on Facebook or the website, and those that probably received a DVD sometime in the near future. Thank you for coming here. If there may be those of you here tonight that are not born again, that is, you have not received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want to give you an opportunity to become born again. The book of Romans, the 10th chapter, verse number 9 and 10, says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, you will be saved. For with your heart you believe unto righteousness, and with your mouth confession is made unto salvation. Now, with everybody being still right now, don't move around right now. I'm going to do this prayer. I'm going to lead you into a prayer, but I want you to be still so others can hear. It's very important because this is a very important moment. Now, Romans 10:9-10 say, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, you will be saved. For with your heart you believe unto righteousness, and with your mouth confession is made unto salvation. If you're here tonight, if you're on Periscope, if you're viewing this video, and you have not been born again, I want to lead you into prayer to get born again. By bowing your heads, I want all of y'all to repeat after me these words so that you can receive the gift of eternal life. Those of you that are already born again, please pray along with us real loud. Say, "Dear God, I come to you now, just as I am, a sinner. I believe that Jesus Christ is your Son. He came to the earth and was crucified on the cross for sin, and he died and went to hell to pay the penalty of sin, and so that I can be saved. And on the third day, you raised him from the dead. I believe this in my heart, and I accept what Jesus Christ did for me. He died for me. He went to hell for me. And I accept what Jesus Christ did for me. I believe you raised him from the dead so I can be saved. Jesus, thank you for saving me. And because I believe this in my heart and I've confessed with my mouth, I'm now saved. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer and you meant it from your heart, we want you to contact us at the end of this broadcast. The address is on there or the website. We want to give a book to you called The New Birth. It's a very important book for you so you know what you just did just a moment ago by receiving Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior so you can be rooted and grounded in the Word. So this, again, I'm Pastor Rodney Hamer and Patricia Hamer of Abiding Faith Christian Center. We want to thank you for tuning in with us, coming to join us here. Remember, John 15:7 says, if you abide abide in me and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will and it shall be done unto you. We'll see you again.